Good evening to everybody.
Today my presentation is on petroleum sector. You know, petroleum is a major energy supply of the countries. More than 35% of the commercial energy requirement is supplied by petroleum sector. So, when you talk about the petrol energy, key issues in today's energy sector discussions are economic development, that is quality of life of people. Then we talk about environmental impacts, that is commonly known as global warming, climate change. Then on top of that, the main topic is sustainability. Sustainability is what is expressed as meet the present day needs without compromising the ability to meet future generation needs. So all these three combined together in talking about the energy. Let's see what is petroleum. Petroleum is actually naturally occurring hydrocarbon of various molecular weights ranging from 1 carbon atom to over 100 carbon atoms. That is a hydrocarbon materials with carbon hydrogens, the main components. In addition to that main components, there are some elements like nitrogen, oxygen, sulfur, halides, metal components in small amount combined with hydrocarbon molecules. That is the petroleum available in the Earth's subsurface. Normally it exists in both all in solid, liquid and gaseous form. Solids is in the form of tar, liquid usually the crude oil and condensate in the gas reservoirs. The gas, so natural, we call it natural gas. There is another type of oil and gas which recently very much interest in exploration and extraction. We call it shale oil and shale gas. Then there is another type of oil, we call it oil sand. That is in certain areas in Canada, we get oil sand in surface of the earth. Most of the oil and gas are beneath the earth surface, but this oil sands are available on surface of the earth. It's just excavate and treat for purification. Formation of petroleum is said to be large quantities of organic materials buried underneath the sedimentary rocks and subject to intense heat and pressure over a period of long time, maybe millions of millions of years. That is what how it was formed. When you talk about the history of the petroleum production, actually petroleum have been used even more than 4000 years BC, before more than 4000 years BC. This is originally on the surface of the earth, they have found some tar materials, but they were not very much aware, but they have used these tar material for various purposes. Not like a fuel, but for, as a material, and they have been used. First oil well was dug in 1857, that is in Canada, to a depth of about 50 feet. About 35 barrels per day of oil extracted from a 70 feet well dug in Pennsylvania. That is the main place in America where oil was first commercially extracted. About 25 years, oil was extracted in Colorado, Ohio, Texas. Then they started extraction of oil, not very much deep, but very shallow wells they have dug, and they have recovered oil. In 1861, first commercial refinery was built, 500 barrels per day. That is normally refinery capacity expressed in barrels per day. That is, you can see the 500 barrels per day refinery. That is very small refinery compared to today's refinery. It's about 1.5 million barrels per day. In 1901, a well dug at depth of 1,180 feet and uncontrollable amount of oil spilled from this well. Right, this is the picture you can see. There is that oil well. They didn't have any system to arrest the oil coming out of those days. Sometimes they allowed to escape the oil from the well several days. That is the way that they didn't have any way of arresting oil when it's gutted out of the well. During 1900, Russia and America produced about 80 and 60 million barrels per day oil. That is after about 30-35 years later, oil extraction has increased to a fairly high level. So that also 65 million barrels of oil per day. But today, today production rate is about 95 million barrels per day. So you can compare the oil consumption today compared to the early stages. Then petroleum oil extraction. Actually, you may have heard about there are several steps to be done. First, they are doing some survey, what is called seismic survey, using ultrasonic sound waves to detect whether the geological structure underneath the surface is oil or gas bearing. So first step is to see that geological structure. Then once you confirm that the structure is oil bearing, it doesn't mean that you are sure about oil is available in that site, but you have to do a drilling to confirm whether petroleum hydrocarbons are available in that particular place. Without drilling, you can't see whether there is oil or not. So next step is the drill test well. Then after drilling well, you can exactly see that oil is available that in that geological structure. So once you do the test well, you do another test drilling to estimate how much oil is available, oil or gas available in that particular site. Then only you start commercial extraction, because you must be sure about the oil available in that site is commercially viable to extract. So once you extract oil, then it undergoes several processes, what is called refining, and to get the present day petroleum fuels such as petrol, kerosene and diesel. So in this process, different type of process required to for different type of hydrocarbon oil or gas, particularly the crude oil. When you extract oil from the oil well, first undergoes what is called pre-treatment process. Pre-treatment process is when you take out the oil, it is not clear oil, because there are so many impurities present in the oil, like water, hydrogen sulfide, salt, and various other components. So first, close to the oil well or in the vicinity of oil well, first you have to treat the oil before it sent to the refinery for the refinery. The first step is pre-treatment. Similarly, for gas also we usually mainly gas you have methane gas, but in addition to that there are some impurities like carbon dioxide, hydrogen sulfide. Those unwanted material also has to be removed at the site before gas is supplied for various purposes. So in that site, the pre-processing is done to remove those impurities like carbon dioxide, hydrogen sulfide, and also they separate methane, the gases, you know, like hydrocarbon, methane, ethane, propane, and butane mainly, and also there are some amount of heavy fraction, like we call it condensate. Those different fractions separate at the site itself. Then methane is the one that we usually known as gas, petroleum gas. That is methane used for different purposes, different way. The methane directly you can use after separating methane gas, you can use when that is used, we call it that's the vehicle block at the vehicle park 2096. Who's either? Anybody is right. Natural gas, we call it natural gas. Natural gas usually directly you can use methane as natural gas, that is we call compressed gas, CNG, compressed natural gas. Compressed natural gas, that is a methane gas. After separating out the methane, you can use for various purposes. Methane gas, we call it, directly you can send through pipeline, we call it compressed natural gas. Or you can convert that gas, that is methane gas, into what is called LNG, liquefied natural gas. Liquefied. The gas, when you can't transport gas intercontinental, you can transport gas through pipeline, maybe about 3,000 kilometers. But when you want to transport gas from one country to another, long distance, from say Middle East to Japan or something, you can't, it is not economical to have a pipeline. What they do is, they convert into liquid. That is, we call it LNG, liquefied natural gas. That is methane gas liquefied, we call it liquefied natural gas. That is, under refrigeration, then you can transport in the special cargoes, refrigerated cargoes, from one place to another. That is LNG. Then, very recently they have developed another process called gas to liquid, GTL, gas to liquid. That is not actually LNG, that is gas converted into liquid fuel like kerosene, diesel, petrol. That is using the catalytic process high pressure, high temperature. That is the latest development. That is very economical and profitable venture present day, because you need not to liquefy gas or use refrigerated cargo to transport petroleum. Then you, after liquefying, after converting the liquid fuels like kerosene and diesel, you can transport as ordinary kerosene and diesel in ordinary tankers. Then the other other category, oil sand and bituminous oil. That is actually the oil sand is a sand mixed with oil. So this open excavation used in normal excavation systems, they excavate sand mixed with oil and wash with some solvent to remove sands from the oil, and then you can refine that oil as the normal crude oil. That is the main components of the hydrocarbon available in the Earth's surface. Actually, this present day the oil and gas not present in the very shallow subsurface. Most of the oil and gas available in the beneath the ocean. Now most of the surface oil has been extracted, and now they have developed their technology going to deep drilling in ocean. So that is the that area is actually there are plenty of oil, not like Earth surface but the normal surface, but beneath the ocean. So continuously they do extraction, and but it is costly business. Normally surface oil extracted less than $10 a barrel, but when you go for the sea, it costly. You can extract very, cost is very high, maybe ranging from $50 to $75 per barrel. That is why price of oil goes up when you go for the ocean drilling. Then another type of oil I think you may have heard about, recently discovered, what is called shale gas and shale oil. Have you heard about that? Shale gas and shale oil. That is the latest development. The shale gas and shale oil is that is actually it's also gas and oil available in the subsurface, but not be able to extract using the ordinary systems, ordinary drilling systems, because that is that oil or gas won't come up when you drill a well. They have to use a special technique, what is called fracking operation. That is using very high pressure water, break the rock structure underneath, and the oil or gas trapped within that structure, after breaking the structure, they flow into the separate well, then they extract. That is the latest development. There are so many oil and gas, or shale oil and shale gas in the world, especially now America is now leading extractor. That is the one of the main reason that present oil price drop is due to the extraction of oil and shale oil and shale gas by Americans. So that is they now they are extracting about 3-4 million barrels per day oil. So most of the oil that they extract they use for their own, and they earlier they used to import the amount of oil, but now they don't import that much. That is why the oil price has come down in the world market. Usually oil, petroleum oil, this is the crude oil properties. Any crude oil types, we can identify the what is the quality of the oil using this type of what is we call it crude oil assay data. So this gives all the properties of the particular crude oil. So using this, you can evaluate the crude oil whether it is suitable for refining a particular refinery or whether it is economical to buy that type of crude oil. Likewise, the total properties of the crude oil is available in this crude assay. In the refining process, crude oil, first step is to when you receive oil for a refinery to process, first step is to separate the different fraction. That is, crude oil, as I mentioned, is a mixture of different type of hydrocarbon, ranging from methane to very high molecular weight. So first step is to separate different fraction. We call it naphtha, kerosene, diesel and residue, depending on the boiling range. That is using the distillation process. Then after separating the crude oil fractions for manufacture, for producing the different products, is further undergo different type of treatment. So that may be catalytic treatment, mainly catalytic process to remove various impurities and increase the quality, like octane number for different petrol and various other processes to convert heavy fractions into light fraction, like hydrocracking, FCC, fluid catalytic cracking, delayed coker. Those are the different type of process used to convert heavy hydrocarbons into light hydrocarbon. So different processes are used in the refinery and to finally get the product on quality. These are the basic systems, just flow diagrams of basic refinery. So what I mentioned is the main first step is the distillation, crude distillation units. Crude is separated into different fractions. Then different fractions convert into different products by using the different process units. So this is a very complex process, although it's just line diagrams show that what is happening in the refinery. Then petroleum products, you can't just send petroleum products for various purposes. You have to maintain some quality parameters, quality. That is, different products we have in the market, we have to have specification. So we have to maintain that specification before dispatch products to the market. So LPG, for example, LPG, we maintain different properties. LPG is mainly propane and butane mixture. It's about 75% is butane and balance is about balance propane. So in addition to the composition, there are other properties like air pressure, then impurities components limited to say, let's say various levels. So before you supply gas for marketing, you have to maintain these properties. Similarly, gasoline, it come from different process units. Like we call it reformate, isomerate, alkylate, that's a different process units, and also can blend with alcohol, this MTB, ethyl tertiary ether, naphtha, LPG. These are the gasoline is not a single component, it's a blend of different type of base oil. To get the correct quality, we need to blend all these components, or one or two components or some more together to get the final composition like this. These are the different product compositions, specification. So we have to maintain this specification, especially for performance of the gasoline engine, IC engine, and storage, transportation, and stability of storage and transportation, and the engine systems protection, engine system protection. So if you don't have good quality, one thing is your engine may not be perform well, especially we have to maintain octane number, that is the main parameter of the gasoline. In the market now you see there are two types of octane, 92 and 95. So that octane number you have to maintain depending on the vehicle that you design for different octane number. So most of the modern vehicle with high performance, high capacity engine needs high octane number, whereas the low power engine you may use low octane number, but no point of using high octane number petrol for vehicle designed for low octane number. Most of the vehicle owners sometimes use high octane number thinking that it gives better performance, but that is not the way. The vehicle is designed for low octane number, you need not put high octane number gasoline. Similarly, like petrol, diesel also is a blend of different petroleum fractions coming from different processes. We call it production is directly from distillation, cracking process, coking process, all diesel from all these processes blend together to get the final product as required. Diesel also have some specification like this. Similar to octane number, diesel have cetane number. That is also engine. If it diesel petrol engine, if your correct octane number is not used, start what is called knocking, engine knocking. Cetane, similarly for the diesel engine, if you don't use the correct cetane number, the minimum cetane number required, we have problems of diesel engine performance. So those are the properties on different product, different specification. So this is the main issue in transport vehicle is the emission of different type of emission: sulfur dioxide, carbon dioxide, oxide of nitrogen, ozone, particulate. So most of the vehicle, modern vehicle, designed to minimize this type of emission because it's harmful to the environment and ecosystem. So vehicle present day designed to have this specification. So these are the different modern vehicle emission specification. So most of the European vehicles, they designed for now, they have gone up to Euro 5, Euro 5, 6 level. So we have to supply fuel according to the specification. If you use this vehicle designed for high quality fuel. This again, this different Euro grade fuels specification, especially petrol sulfur level now has brought down to about 10 ppm. Our market sulfur level, we have 10 ppm sulfur, that is a Polestar diesel 10 ppm sulfur, and other type of sulfur is about 500 2000 ppm. So all these are parameters you have to maintain before you dispatch products to market. Then present trend is to use a different type of biofuel blend with hydrocarbon fuel, especially the ethanol is used. Most of the countries now use ethanol for blending with gasoline. I think you may have experienced some time back there is an issue when we imported some gasoline parcel blend with ethanol, had a lot of issues in the vehicle about 3-4 years ago. That is, when you use ethanol, you have to be very careful. You have to have special dispensation systems to avoid mix with water. If the ethanol petrol blend is mixed with water, there is a heavy quality problems because it's separate out the oil and ethanol water mixture, and it's very corrosive and damage to the vehicle. Now the ethanol also, they have given some standard specification for ethanol. If you are going to manufacture ethanol fuel, so there is a STM specification. It's like this. Right. Then the petroleum mainly used for transport. About 50%, more than 50% of the petroleum in the world used for transport, especially surface transport, air transport, and sea transport. Then petroleum use industry for heat and power, then power generation, industrial chemicals, pharmaceutical industry, then household for cooking, heating, cooling, air conditioning, etc. Right? When you go back to the energy situation in the world, total energy in 2014, equivalent to the million barrels per day of oil equivalent, is about 265 million barrels per day, out of which oil comes to about 35%, natural gas 70 million barrels per day, about 26%, coal 75, the hydroelectricity 18, nuclear 16, other renewable like wind, solar, biomass has come to about 4.5%. This is a 2014 total world energy consumption. So energy goes for industry about 27%, transport 28%, residential 36%, and also energy used for non-energy purposes like petrochemicals, various other pharmaceutical, various other purposes, that also about 9%. So out of this, but 50% liquid petroleum, that is crude oil, goes for transport sector. surface and air, water and air. This is the future oil supply scenario, that is present, past, present and forecasted demand for 2030, that where it come from, supply, different sources, we call non-OPEC production, that is there are OPEC and OPEC oil petroleum producing exporting countries and non-OPEC, there is two categories, so mainly controlled by OPEC countries, but they have a cartel, they get together and they control the oil market usually. Then ethanol, biodiesel, GTL, gas to liquid, CTL, coal to liquids, processing gain. Actually the processing gain is when you process crude oil and crude oil, especially crude oil, there is a gain, the volume gain. When you produce 100 barrels, you get 101, 102 barrels as product because the volume span when you break into the small molecules. So total world forecast is 102 million barrels per day. Different products wise demands is like this, it's a million barrel. Main demand is for gasoline, highest demand is for gasoline, then diesel, others are less than that, that's a total product wise demand. Then production and reserves, production, reserves and consumption wise, top 10 countries, that is Saudi Arabia is the number one reserves, that highest reserves is in Saudi Arabia, then Venezuela, Canada, like that, is that is a reserves. So production wise also Saudi Arabia come first, then Russia, United States, China, Iran, Canada, Mexico. Consumption wise, of course, United States use about 20% of the world production used by United States. Right. Then main issue now, I think you may have heard, oil, gas, usually fossil fuel, is a finite resource. One day it might be over. So how long will oil and gas will available for human consumption? That is usually the measured by reserved production ratio. How much oil is reserved, how much oil is available, and production rate. Divide by production rate, you can calculate the number of years to serve. Actually, when you look at this reserved production ratio, is always going up. For last 40 years, when you take last 40 years, the reserve production ratio has gone up again. But despite the fact last 40 years, the oil consumption has increased by fourfold. Oil consumption has increased by fourfold, but still the reserve production has ratio has little more than 40 years ago. The reason is when the prices going up, there are oil well that you can extract economically, because oil prices below the certain price, some wells is not economically extracted. But when the oil price increasing, you go for the high extraction cost well and use high technology for extraction, then you have more oil, more and more oil. Many people believe that according to these figures, oil will last for another 40-50 years, but the way that oil price going up, definitely there will be oil reserves, there will be oil reserves for more than 200 years. Again, this reserve production ratio of different price. The oil price is fluctuation. Actually, oil prices fluctuate not because of the cost of production, but because of the various political instability in the oil producing countries. So, depending on the various issues, the oil prices, they control the way they want, especially OPEC countries. When there is a political unrest or war, they cut down their oil production, then oil price goes up. Or if they increase the production, the oil price come down. That is how the oil price fluctuate in the world. The present day, of course, there is a two-pronged approach. The Saudi Arabia or OPEC countries, they have not cut down the production, whereas the oil production in the America has increased. That is the main reason for coming down the oil prices from, say, about $110-$115 a barrel, now it has come down to $50 a barrel. Then another issue is, now most people look for renewable energy for electricity generation and other purposes. But countries where large amount of electricity is generated, they mainly use, what is the fuel they use? Coal. Sometimes more than 75% of the electricity generated from coal, which is very cheap. And gas, indigenous gas, that is gas where available in their own soil, they use gas for electricity generation. The other area, that nuclear, hydro, wind, hydro. So more than 90-95% of the electricity generated from the cheap energy sources. So if you are going for renewable, definitely you must have cheap oil for electricity generation. Otherwise you can't go for renewable, because renewable is costly. Because you have to subsidize from cheap oil earning to generate renewable. So this is the different type of energy sources used in different countries. Most of the countries, they use coal for electricity generation. In Sri Lanka, there's about coal. Presently, now coal has come up. It's about 12%. Still, Sri Lanka generate electricity from oil, hydro. In 2014 is 50%, 2013, right. The prices, again prices, another factor, price movement is the depreciation of dollar. When these two, the red and blue, there's a in dollar and euro terms. So you can remember in 2000, in the euro currency started in 2000, euro and dollar almost equal. Of course, dollar is more stronger than euro. Now, 1 euro is equal to $1.4. So, dollar in related to the euro has depreciated. That is another reason for oil price increase during the past years. Then it's come to petroleum sector in Sri Lanka. Actually, you know, before nationalization, oil industry in Sri Lanka, all oil business were done by multinational companies like Esso, Caltex, Mobil. So, in 1961, the Parliament Act brought to nationalize petroleum industry in Sri Lanka and established Ceylon Petroleum Corporation in 1962 to gain the monopolistic right to all type of petroleum activities in the country, import, export, processing, marketing, storage and all these exploration activities also under the Petroleum Corporation. Then that remained till about 2003, which liberalized the petroleum industry in the country, allowing some other players to enter into the market, especially LIOC came. Petroleum sector distribution and distribution sector, storage and distribution sector converted into a common use of facilities, what is called CPSTL, giving 1/3 of that share to the LIOC. Thereby, most of the other petroleum products also started marketing by different companies. Now there are about 12-15 different marketing companies for market the other product like lubricating oil, bitumens, other gases, etc. in the country. And then Petroleum Resources Act established in 2003 again to carry out exploration activities in the Sri Lankan territory. Sapakasgada refinery, of course, built in 1969, that is about 45 years ago, and we have facilities to unload crude oil from mid-sea, what is called SPBM, single point buoy mooring, that is to unload crude oil from large tankers. The storage facilities are there, Mutrajala, Kolonnava, Sapakasgada, and there are island-wide network of distribution systems, product depots, connected through railway lines, that is, there are about 9 stations like that, small depot. All are connected with railway lines so that railway transportation can be done and to transport fuel. Domestic consumption keep on increasing like this. 2013 product demand is mainly our demand is for diesel because most of the goods and passenger transport use diesel fuel. Then fuel oil that is for power generation, actually this will come down in future times with the increases coal generation. So this is gasoline. These are the percentage of using. When you take the sector wise, industry use very small compared to the transport and power. Transport sector again about 55%, power 29%, industry 6% and domestic 10% petroleum consumption. In future growth and expected demand growth is like this, is this this present demand and projected demand is for the last up to 30 years is like this. Present demand is about 4.5 million barrels, million tons. In terms of barrels, 95 million barrels per day is a million tons per year. So growth rate about 2 to 3% per year growth rate during the last 10 years, and we'll project a similar growth rate during the next couple of decades. Again, diesel is the most demand petroleum products in the country. Actually, right now, the petroleum refinery was built in 1969, the capacity of 50,000 barrels per day, depending on the demand at that time. Now the demand has gone up to about nearly 100,000 barrels per day. The refinery is not capable of supplying refined products to the market. Only about now, right now it's about 30 to 40% refined products coming from the refinery. Balance is import and supply as refined product. So import and supply is fairly costly because the main reason to establish the refinery at that time also to save the foreign exchange to the country. Of course, about 25% of the foreign exchange could be saved by having a refinery locally. Even now, about 15 to 20% of the foreign exchange could be saved if we have refinery to produce total demand of the country. This again, same. The present refinery actually main issue is that design based on the technology available during that time. Basic refinery, we call it hydro skimming refinery because it's a basic refinery. But nowadays the refineries are very advanced refineries. They have different process like hydro cracking process, coking process, isomerization. All you can convert heavy fuel into light fuel, adding the value to the residual fuel. Otherwise, present day the refinery we have in the country produce about 40% of the residual oil out of the barrel. So residual is less value than crude oil. So if you are selling 40% of the crude oil barrels at lower value, you can't operate the refinery profitably. So that is why most of the country, they have used some other process like hydrocracking to convert residual oil to product like diesel, petrol, kerosene, which has high value. So by that way, you can now, about the present day is about 39-40% residual oil, whereas modern refinery, you can bring down the residual oil percent to a very low level, like this 3-4%. From this 39 dependent process unit you use. So all other converted into high value products, which give a very high margin for operation of the refinery. So actually now there are proposals to increase the capacity of the and incorporate modern technology for a refinery. So by having refinery, you can save annually about $300-400 million per year if you have a refinery to produce local demand alone. So that is huge amount compared to our economy, because $300-400 million per year means you can do any type of projects without taking single cents borrowing from the outside. That is the huge amount. So, oil exploration activities started, actually this was started long time back. I can remember in 1970s, we started oil exploration. We did some exploration activity in the Mena, but it was unsuccessful. Then we went for the offshore. Offshore, during the last couple of years, the exploration activities were speedied, and I think you may have heard about present status, about they have, we awarded the exploration activity to the Indian company, what is called CAN India, a subsidiary, CAN, then CAN Lanka, a subsidiary of CAN India. They have done some preliminary investigation. They have dug 3 wells on offshore. Out of that, 2 wells were successful. They found gas in that 2 wells, and also later they have done some evaluation test well to see how much gas is available, what is the, whether it is a commercially viable extract. The most of the sometimes, you know, although there are oil or gas, the next step is very costly, extraction of oil. So before you going for the extraction oil, you have to evaluate, assess the amount of oil or gas available to justify your investment. So one well they have evaluated, and they have reported that about 4 million tons of oil equivalent gas is available in that particular well. So I don't know whether it is reasonably justifiable, because if the other wells also proven to be successful, then you may have to some chances of going for that. If not, if this only this well is 4 million tons of gas oil, is not very attractive things. So they continue their investigation. So we'll see what's happened in the future. So this is the infrastructure available in the country. Crude oil tankers, from tankers there is a SPBM from Colombo port to Colombo port. Crude oil transport to the refinery, then from the refinery crude oil products transport to the storage facility, Koronnava, Borogodavat, Koronnava, Sabgaskanda terminal. From there on, they transport to other areas in the country. So, this is the basic things that I want to discuss. You can ask any question.
Shale gas.
Actually, the normal oil and gas, they drill well. And actually, they oil or gas, they accumulate in a reservoir, I think, right? Accumulate in a reservoir. When you drill a hole, oil or gas will come out through the hole, right? That is a complex process, but it's just simply it's a you drill and take oil or gas. But the shale oil and shale gas, it's not in a reservoir like that. It's not collected to the reservoir. It is trapped in rope structure. Wrapped in rope structure. That is, oil or gas form in rope structure, that is called shale rock. The shale rock structure, in that rock structure, oil and gas, they are in pocket wise. It's not moved into a reservoir. What they do is, they do horizontal drilling. Now they can do the horizontal, just like, not like vertical drilling, horizontal drilling. After some time you can drill horizontally. Horizontal drilling sent to very high pressure water, very high pressure, maybe 100 bars, right? Very high pressure water jet and blast the rock structure with the water, high pressure water, blast, then crack the rock structure, and then the oil that is there in the pocket flow into a well. Then they stack. That is the thing. But this is a very costly operation, because costly and environmentally hazardous operation, because you have a huge amount of water also for this process. That, but still it is cheaper, but above a certain price level. If the crude oil price come below something like $60, it's not attractive. If it's above $60-$70, attractive. If it's $100, more profitable. Right? That is why they started, the oil price went up to about 100, they started doing this. And now, magazine and various sources say, oil, the shale oil business is not profitable now, because oil price has come down, and that is the one reason Saudi OPEC countries doesn't want to cut down their production. They want to attack shale gas, oil, gas and oil production, because they want to stop that. Any other question? Because I can't give all the things in the slides, but if you have any clarification. Sorry?
Ethanol.
Yeah, actually ethanol, one thing is, ethanol mainly produced from sugar, especially Brazil. Brazil is the country that produce ethanol as well as sugar, right? That is the huge quantities they produce. The reason ethanol, the cane yield in ethanol, Brazil is about 4 times what we produce. Their yield is very high. So, if we are going to produce, we can't even produce our sugar. We produce only about 10% of the balance, 90% we import. Right? Our yield is very low. The Brazil, I think if you go for the geographical system of the Brazil, it's like India, no? Huge country. The population is very small compared. It's not more than, I think, 10-15 million, right? And also, the biggest river, Amazon River, flows all over the country, right? It's a lot of water. To get industry, you need a lot of water, right? So, they have very high yield. They produce at very cheap level. Cheap, that is why they have gone up to alcohol production, ethanol production. So ethanol, if we are going to produce, we can't even produce ethanol for our own consumption. We can't produce. That is actually good biofuel. But in our case, the cost of production higher than the imported petroleum. That is the one reason. Even if you are, you know, even if you are possible now, marketing now, ethanol marketing is government tax and marketing. Maybe, I don't know how much per liter, right? But that is, most of that is tax. But even without tax, the cost of production more than gasoline you import. So that is the one reason. So if you are, most of the countries now, those other countries other than Brazil, America produces ethanol from corn or wheat, but they subsidize. They can subsidize for energy. Even other renewable energy, they can subsidize because about 90% of their energy comes from low energy sources like coal, gas, nuclear. So in our country, if we can't subsidize because we are not being subsidized. We produce energy at high energy sources. If you go for coal or something for about 90%, you can subsidize for nuclear. That's what I said earlier also. Nana mentioned now Kyan Lanka has gone out. They have left the place. Right? They have spent about $300 million. But now they have vacated. Because one thing is they wanted to sell gas produced from the Mana basins at a very high price. Normally, now of course prices have further down, come down, right? Those days when the barrel was about $100-$110, the LNG, imported LNG, we can import about $15-$16 per million BTU. But what they wanted, they want to sell the gas produced from their well at the same price that we import, almost same price we import. So that is the problem that we had those days, because no point of buying gas at that high price, because they want to recover total investment within few years. I think there should be some compromise, no? Both parties must be benefited. That is the one reason they have left the place. So, actually, I don't know if they are really aware that the reserves available there is substantial. They won't go like that, no? After spending $300 million. We spent about $300 million. It's not peanut. Huh?
Do we know how much volume we have?
Sorry?
Do we know how much volume we have?
According to their estimate, one well, about 4 million tons. 4 million tons is our present consumption is, total country's consumption is 5 million tons per year. 5 million tons per year. So 4 million total quantity. It is, you know, it is not a thing that we should go for. They say, but they are not confirmed, otherwise that it has more than that. But I don't know why they have abandoned that. They abandoned, they tried to estimate the volume, but they couldn't. They have abandoned that. Oh, I don't know, there is some way of getting oil or gas through horizontal drilling from other side. Sorry?
We have
extract oil,
otherwise
it will leak from some other plant. No, it's not. They're sealed. It won't leak out. That is oil drilling system. It's a protected system. Because Even you do a test well, after abandoning that test well, you have to seal it. There are proper way of doing that. Even that is one thing you can, I think you may have heard about 3-4 years back, BP, British Petroleum, they have some problems in Gulf of Mexico. They couldn't arrest that leak and they start out. But anyway, they have done it against. They spend a lot of money, but oil drilling systems, they have the system to plug in. In my personal view, if I am the petroleum minister, I never reduce the prices, right? Actually, true that petroleum price came down, right, from $110 to $50. But most of the oil consuming countries in the world, not producing countries, consuming countries, they did not reduce the price because they took that opportunity to develop their infrastructure with that money. For example, for our case, we spend about $5,000 million per year, right, for import of petroleum. From $110 to $50-$55, it's a half the price. That is our total expenditure from last June to this June, 1 year now. That's 1 year. We could have saved, actually we saved about $2,500 million. $2,500 million. But in the real terms, we pass on to the consumers, but consumers, who benefited that? Bus fare came down, or goods transport came down, nothing happened. So some personal, they have benefited. But if they didn't do that, right, that amount, we can save and use that money. Of course, during the past couple of years, petroleum consumption lost heavily due to subsidies. About 200 billion, more than 200 billion lost due to the subsidies given to the consumers. That amount, they could have recovered that money during that period. So, you know, that is technically, I'm speaking technically, that it's very benefits acquired by the people are not that satisfactory. But they could have done more than that. That amount, they can, even now they are struggling to build the refinery. They don't have funds to build the refinery. That is building refinery $1,200 million. Now already they could have saved $2,500 million. So all this money could have channeled to build the refinery, which you can save about $300-400 million per year. $300-400 million per year is how much? For comparison, you take a main project did in this country. It take about 4-5 years, no? Per year, if you take per year for a project, it's not more than $100 billion, right? Per project, bigger project. So $400 million saving means you can do similar project, four similar projects simultaneously. That is the amount that.
Sir,
so
we can't meet our demand. So that we have to
bring
the
importer,
finished product,
yes.
So anyhow,
Yeah, actually the refining is profitable thing. Import crude oil and refine locally.
My question is, if it is a profitable business, why we gave that chance to India values?
Actually, I am the one who fought for not to do that thing, right? out of all this, right? Actually, government gave 1/3 of the share to LIOC. Then the next step was to give another 1/3 to another Indian company. So I am the one person who saved that actually by giving and taking various steps and explaining to the even the, at that time president. At that time president. He was very adamant. She was very adamant at that time. She said, no, definitely we are doing it. Then I explained, no point of doing like that. This is the way you should do. Ultimately he agreed that. He at that point only he gave it up. Otherwise that also will begin. IOC?
And
yeah.
What is the difference between?
No, different in the sense what? In the sense?
It's a chemical, not price wise.
No, they are both companies supply from the same time. Right? Same time they supply, but they import oil, IOC import oil, put the our own same tank. Our CPC also import, put the oil into the same tank. And there are some accounting system. How much they have brought into that tank, how much CPC has brought into that tank. Then ultimately, the only accounts goes on there. Right? There nothing else.
Then why they have different product
range? That is a different way they are marketing. Right? Now, that is one area that harmful to the petrol industry in these countries by doing now. See, when the CPCs are doing monopolistic marketing, there was a cross subsidies. That is, we sell kerosene to poor people at the low price and gasoline at high price. When the loss from the kerosene is recovered from the gasoline selling. But now what is happening? When subsidies are given, the price of kerosene is reduced, the person who market that is losing that. Now LIOC won't market kerosene. LIOC won't market kerosene. Because they are losing. But they market petrol. Petrol market at high price. So now the CPC losing both way, because CPC won't get subsidies from the government. CPC sell products to the people at low price, losing. But LIOC won't sell low price products. By that way, LIOC making high profit. Sorry?
Efficiency.
Yeah, efficiency in the sense, you know, as I explained, modern refinery, this is the basic refinery, right? Basic refinery built in 1969 according to technology available at that time. The present refineries, I explained, but 40% of the crude oil comes as a residual oil. 40% of the barrel comes as a residual oil. Residual oil market about $10-$15 below the crude oil price. That is how much you use losing, right? But modern refinery, all this residual oil convert into disulfide kerosene. So that 40% can bring down to 5%. Right? So all this converted into a higher value, that is, petrol and diesel products, prices are higher than crude oil, that is $10-$15 higher than crude oil. So that all converted into high product, that is the efficiency. That is, we are losing now.
Make that carbon, only crude oil, petrol, and other gas, right? We can earn that, we can save something, but there's no any.
Any?
No, any plan?
Yeah, actually, now this project was there for last maybe decade, right? This capacity increase and incorporating the high-tech process started actually it started in 1983. I don't know whether you can remember, there's a project called hydrocracker project. Hydrocracker, that is without capacity increase, hydrocracker, that is to convert residual oil to product, what I mentioned, right? That was because of the some tug of war between politicians, they stopped that. That's 1981, right? Then proposal came and almost about to sign the contract in 2001. Again, they postponed because at that time there was a discussion to liberalize petroleum sector in this country, and that is how the LIOC and all this came in 2003, right? Again, that was stopped. Then now again started in 2007. I think you can remember the Iran president came and laid down the foundation stones also to build the refinery, right? Again, that was not materialized. And right throughout, continuously, I was pushing, but no good political decision came out. I think you can remember in 1969, those days most of the people in this country didn't know what is crude oil. What is crude oil? But they are, that time, the politician and this technocrat, they had the courage to send out all these multinational companies and build the refinery, and that was a very successful venture. At that time it was said that within 3 years they have recovered total investment. Within 3 years they have recovered total investment. Likewise, this one also, within three and a half years you can recover, even though it is $1,200 million. Within 3 and 3-4 years you can recover total investment. Yeah. Now what I explained, first step is to separate different fraction. Different fraction means petroleum crude oil is a mixture of hydrocarbon having different molecular weights from C1 to say 100C. Right? Carbon atoms 1 to varying from 100, more than 100. So, first fraction is light hydrocarbon and light hydrocarbon, light gases and LPG. The second fraction is what is called naphtha, that is boiling range about 35 to 160. That fraction we use to produce gasoline, petrol. Then next fraction is kerosene, that is boiling range from 140 to 240. That fraction used as kerosene and jet fuel. Then further heavier fraction. Further heavier fraction is the one that produces diesel. So one First step is to separate out the different fraction, then naphtha alone, naphtha itself you can't use as a gasoline. The quality is not very good. Yeah, octane number is low, other impurities are there. So you have to increase the octane number by another process. What is called reforming process, catalytic reforming process. That process convert low octane value fuel to high octane value. Right? Then there you can get, there are so many processes converting isomerization, alkylation process, like that, different process. The blend of those components ultimately end up with the gasoline pool. Then you can produce gasoline. Likewise, diesel, of course, straight run gas, diesel, you have to purify, you have to remove sulfur and improve the quality, basically. Right? Then likewise, you have to subject to various different processes to get the final product specification. Sorry? Yeah, yeah. Any question? So, you need to worry about oil one over by next 40 years, right? It will remain for another 200 years minimum, right? Only thing, the price will go up. It won't be a problem, price, even if at $200 per barrel, it won't be a problem, because about 40 years ago, crude oil barrel was $1 a barrel. Today, before is $100. But people can afford to buy products at $100 more than this when it was in $1. Right? So that is it's only a change, right? Not affordability won't be an issue, but oil is available. I think offshore oil, even 10% oil, still have not extracted. Right, no more question. So you conclude it. Right, okay, thank you.